That morning, we had started painting the football field for the kids. The phone rings, it's across the field, and I picked up the telephone. The voice on the other end said, "Mr. Gale, this is Vidalia Sheriff. You need to get down here immediately." And I could tell by the quiver in his voice that it had to be serious. And I could just feel the air coming out of my body.
The Gale family of Lawrenceville, Georgia was a picture-perfect family. But that picture was shattered in the fall of 2003. Kip Gale had just started college when he and a friend went dove hunting one weekend. They heard a flock of birds in the distance, quickly picked up their 12-gauge shotguns, and took aim. His friend's gun went off at close range, hitting Gip in the side of the head. Richard and Beth Gale and their son Taylor got in their car to make the 5-hour trip from Atlanta to Savannah.
We prayed the whole way, and we kept trying to get through to the hospital in Savannah, and no one would take our call. Finally, my dad, as a physician, was able to get through to the neurosurgeon, the chief neurosurgeon. He called us, and he said, "Your son is alive, but barely."
He had just literally hundreds of pellets in his brain substance, and was initially had a very low Glasgow coma score. Was in and out of consciousness.
I can remember all the way down there hearing my wife calling everyone and saying, "Please pray for our son. Please pray for our son."
"Please" was one of the only words we could utter out loud. Just please.
My head was, "God, please keep him alive at least until we can get there."
When the Gales finally reached the hospital, they realized it was as bad as they feared.
Obviously, he was in acute condition, very swollen, very bruised, had bandages everywhere. He was kind of unrecognizable, you know, and as a 14-year-old kid, that scares you at first.
They told us that Gip had just been given his last rites by the chaplain of the hospital. Well, hearing that made it very real.
Gip survived the next few hours. The doctor said if he lived, he'd likely be in a vegetative state for the rest of his life.
I can remember looking at Richard and saying, "What are we even praying for now? If he does survive, it's going to be horrible. I don't want our child to suffer." And Richard looked at me and he grabbed me by the shoulders and he said, "We're praying for a miracle. That's what we're praying for."
It wasn't long before literally people from all over the world were now praying for our son.
Gip spent the next 3 days in a coma. Then a nearly impossible thing happened. Gip opened his eyes and spoke.
Gip's brain was destroyed and a large portion of it gone and filled with birdshot pellets. So when my dad heard Gip speak his first words, and they were cognitive, "How's Yeller?" Our dog's name was Yeller. He just fell onto the side rails. He turned and he looked at us and he said, "You do realize we've all just witnessed a miracle." He just spoke with thought. Medicine cannot explain this.
He was later transferred to the Shepherd Center in Atlanta. While there, Gip suffered a number of complications.
He got an infection in his brain, MRSA, and after a couple of weeks of saying, wow, you know, a miracle, he's made it, he survived, he's gonna make it, and then to almost lose him again was very disheartening and another test of our faith.
We actually witnessed 3 or 4 of cardiopulmonary arrests. He had to be resuscitated a number of times, was rushed to emergency surgery a number of times.
Though discouraged at times, they clung to each other and to their faith in God through it all.
I can remember like yesterday looking at Gip and thinking, how are we gonna make it? I mean, we've never been tested like this. And it was almost like God put this thought into my head, you know what, Beth? It's time to start believing what you say you believe.
God was taking care of us even at that point. I think Beth and I and Taylor all felt a peace about what was going on at the time.
Eventually, Gip stabilized. He was hospitalized for 6 months and spent another 3 years in therapy. He had to learn to walk, talk, and function again at a normal level.
At the time, I didn't really wasn't really aware of how many people were praying for me, but I believe that's what really saved my life.
I have had, in 30 years, many severely injured patients. I don't think anybody can top what Gip overcame. His chances for surviving and for pulling through, particularly where he has come now, would be less than 0.1%. Truly miraculous.
Beth says they couldn't have made it without the earthly angels who walked with them. People like Gip's football coach and Young Life leader, Chuck Scott.
Coach Scott was always there for my family, and I didn't know exactly how much he was doing behind the scenes, but found out later that he pretty much carried my family through the whole thing.
Gip was wearing a hat signed by comedian Jeff Foxworthy the day he was shot. Not only did Jeff give him a new one, he dedicated a page to Gip in his redneck calendar.
Jeff is not just a great comedian. Jeff has a true heart for God and has been a huge friend to our family.
Beth was so humbled by the love and support, she wrote, "And then came the angels." She hopes to encourage people going through similar situations.
I just felt really God-pressed that I needed to write this and I needed to glorify God through this and help encourage others to do the same and go to Him for help instead of relying on our human weakness.
This has really affected my faith by showing me firsthand how powerful God is. This was an impossible feat for me to go from being shot in the head to getting through college, graduating, going out and living on my own. And it's unfathomable how powerful He is and all that He's gotten me and my family through.